Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know, we are all very, very special. When we realize how special we are, when we realize what we can do for God, and when we realize how God can use your life, your eyes can suddenly be open. You know, in Psalm 139, verses 16, starting verse 16, Psalm 139, it says that, all the days of my life before one of them came to me, that you have written them in your book. Oh God, how precious are your thoughts. What it says here is that God has written in a book of life in heaven about your life. That God has a very, very special plan in your life that you can become a great person. But many people always say, oh, I'm nobody. I'm not educated. I'm not rich. I have problems. My family has problems. And many people say, I cannot do great things for God. This is, you know, one lie Satan likes to use on you. And you say, oh, I cannot do great things. I can only do small things. That we don't think that we can become a special person. But God says that your life is written in a book of life in heaven. Let me ask you this. When God wrote your life in heaven, does he say, well, he's a failure? He is going to have all kinds of problems. He'll get divorced. He will fail in everything. Is God going to write that in heaven? Is God going to write that in heaven that you are a failure? No. He will write, you can do great things for God. Amen. Amen. He will write in heaven that you can do great things for God. But many people, one day when we go to heaven, and you look at the book of life, what God has planned for you, and you realize God's plan is very, very great. Yes. That you can do great things for God. Amen. And then you say, how come God's plan is so great, but what I've done is so small? For many reasons, many Christians' life is not used to a great extent because they don't think they can do great things for God. They think, you know, they are nobody. They think, you know, it will never come to my turn that I can do great things. That is what the lie, a lie of Satan that makes many Christians bound up and can do nothing for God. But God can actually do great things in our life. I'm not kidding. I'm not lying. Now for myself, when I go into mission field and when I minister to different people, I see the life transform. Amen. I see, you know, when I do teaching, and you can do that too. You can, you know, talk about the love of God, talk about the plan of God, talk about how God can bless us, and also you pray for people, and you can carry the power of God, and you will see people change.
Amen.
Before I experienced the Holy Spirit, I found that it was very difficult to transform people's life. Before I was filled with the Holy Spirit. But after I was filled with the Holy Spirit, I find that when I pray for people, many people experience change. I have all kinds of stories. And you can do it too. You know, I train our people to pray for people. And they found that they all, when they pray for people, they all see people experience the presence of God.
Amen.
You can be trained.
Amen.
You can be trained to carry the power of God. And you can be used by God. And then suddenly you realize, I can do it. Can you say to the next person, I can do it.
I can do it.
I can do it by the power of God.
Yeah.
I can do great things by the power of God.
I can do great things by the power.
Hallelujah. So this is God's wonderful plan. It's written in heaven.
Awesome.
That God has a wonderful plan in our life that he can do great things for God.
Amen.
Before I was filled with the Holy Spirit, I thought as a pastor, I just preach, teach every week. I don't see people's life change greatly. But after I experienced the Holy Spirit, when I went to the mission field and prayed for people, and when I led different meetings, I saw people's lives transformed right away when they experienced God. And that is God's plan too. It's written in heaven for you that the power of the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you'll receive power to be the witness of Jesus from Jerusalem to the end of the world. That it is His plan. Let me share some story of how I've transformed some people's life by the power of God. It's not my power, it's the power of God. One time I was in a meeting, and there was a minister that I knew. And then there was another minister, but this other minister I don't know, I did not know. And then the two of them were talking, and they said, this minister I did not know, he said, I have one person who came to my, who comes to my church, and she has evil spirit, and she saw evil spirit. And then he said, I'm going to ask one famous pastor in Hong Kong to come and pray for her to release the evil spirit. And then when I heard that, I said, you know, if you ask this famous pastor, you might have to wait for a long time. But I can go with you today to the hospital. So I went with him to the hospital and prayed for that girl who saw evil spirit all the time. And when people prayed for her, she could not say the prayer because the evil spirit inside her stopped her talking about Jesus, stopped her praying to Jesus. And then I prayed for her, and after a while she became calm. And then she became peaceful again, and then she can follow the prayer. And then the doctor saw her after that. And then the doctor told the family, well, now she's normal. You can take her home now. But before that, the doctor said, she has to go to the mental hospital. Because she was totally out of control. But after the prayer, her life was changed. And then one of her friends came. I mean, actually, she had many friends who came. And one of her friends, also a young woman, dressed very in a professional way. And I said to all of them, I said, I can pray for you to protect you from the evil spirit. And when I prayed for this young lady, she experienced the power of God, just like this man just now. I can see him swaying in the power of God. And I told her, the power of the Holy Spirit is upon you. And then I said, open your heart, hunger for God. And then she really did it, hunger for God. And suddenly the power of God came upon her and she started to laugh. And we were in front of the elevator in a hospital. There were people walking by. But she was filled with the Holy Spirit and she started laughing for about 5 minutes. And then she started to cry very loudly for maybe 20 minutes. And then after that, she started to laugh again. And I asked her what happened. She said, I've been hurt many times. And during the prayer, all the sadness came out. And that's why I cried. And then at first I felt the joy of the Lord. And then all the sadness came out. And then after that, she experienced the joy of the Lord again. And then she started to go to my church. And then later, she's now a missionary.
Wow.
Just one encounter, and I brought this person to be a missionary. Now, at that time, someone came to my church, and this person has a very special experience because she had a dream. You know, at that time I was serving in a Lutheran church. And a Lutheran church have candles. Have you been to Lutheran churches? They're candles. And she had a dream in the morning before she came to church. Because she wanted to visit my church. And she just wanted to bring her relative to the church. And then she had a dream. And she saw in the church there are two candles. And then she came to the church and found that there were candles in the church. And she was surprised. And then she came home that day, and then the husband came home because the husband had to work, so the husband could not go to church on that day. And the husband asked her, "Is the pastor bald? Is the pastor without hair?" And then she said, "How can you know that?" He said, I dreamed about him. I saw last night in a dream, I saw the pastor had no hair on the top of his head." And the two of them started to come to my church. So the woman saw the church with the candle, and the husband saw me bald, preaching. And they started to come to my church. And the woman, after a while, she started to cry when I prayed for her. She cried a lot. And then she said, because she came to Hong Kong, she has been hurt by many people, and all the sadness came out. And then one day she said to me, "Can you go back to my home village and pray for my relatives, my family members, because they have believed in Jesus for so long, but they never experienced the joy of the Lord." And so she took me to her family, and I prayed for them. And they got healed, and they start to get joy. Even an 89-year-old grandmother started to let her fear the Lord. At first she said, "I've been in church for decades and I never saw people laugh in the Lord." But after a while she started to laugh, the joy of the Lord filled her. And then also there was one woman who had all kinds of problems, and she said, "How come every time I cry and every time other people laugh and I just cry?" But after a while she also experienced the joy of the Lord. And I asked this woman who came to my church, I asked her, "You see the power of God, are you willing to serve the Lord?" And she said, "Yes." And now she's a minister. I have brought transformation to people, and you can do that too. Don't think that you cannot do it. Can you say it? Declare in Jesus' name, "I can do it by the power of God.
I can do my power of God.
I can do great things for God.
I can do great things for God.
God has a wonderful plan in my life.
God has a wonderful plan in my life.
It's all written in the book of life in heaven.
It's all written in the book of life in heaven."
Do you believe that?
Yes.
But there are many reasons people don't go into this wonderful plan of God. In Romans 12, 1-2, it talks about, "Offer your body as a living sacrifice to God." Many people don't offer the body as a living sacrifice to God. And also, Paul said, "Do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the new renewing of your mind. And then you will discern this good, perfect, and pleasing will of God." Now, how can people discern this good and perfect and pleasing will of God? When they dedicate their life to God. When they're not transformed to the world. When they are transformed by the renewing of the mind. So when people follow that, then they will enter the perfect plan of God. God has a wonderful plan, but this plan, you don't enter automatically. Just by going to church, you won't enter. You have to follow God totally. Live in the presence of God all the time. Pray to God all the time. Love God all the time. And obey Him. And read the Bible. And preach the gospel. Tell people about Jesus. And then when you obey God, He will put you into this perfect plan of God. But when you look at Christians, are all Christians like that? Are all Christians following this perfect plan of God?
Lord,
should be, right? But they are not. And many Christians have fights in the home. Quarrels at home. Arguments at home. And many Christians are not happy. Have you seen unhappy Christians? In the worship time, they're very happy. But when they go home, they're not happy. Why? Because they have not dedicated their life as a living sacrifice to God. And they are conforming to the world, and they're not transformed by the renewal of the mind, so they don't enter this perfect plan of God. And God gave me an idea. This perfect plan of God is like an A plan. When you really follow God, when you believe in Jesus, you will enter the A plan of God. But when we sin, or when we don't follow God, we go into B plan. And then you sin more, you go into C plan. And if you marry a non-Christian, you go to D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K. You keep going down. That's why many Christians say, how come my life is full of problems? Oh, so very often unhappy. So many Christians that they find that life is difficult. Instead of being joyful and full of power and being influential, many Christians' life is like suffering. And some people say, I want Jesus to come back soon so that I don't have to work. You know, some people, I even had that thought before. I said, Jesus, Lord, come back. It's too hard to work, too hard to minister to people. But now I enjoy it. I enjoy ministering to people. And you know, there are ministers who have a fear of Sunday syndrome. What does it mean? When they come to Sunday, they say, oh, I have to preach again. What can I do? What can I preach? Because they don't have the inspiration from God. Yeah. And many Christians say it's hard to be a strong Christian. So very often I'm weak. I have no strength. I don't have joy. I have all kinds of problems. Why? Are they entering into the perfect plan of God? They're not in the plan A. They may be in a plan F, or G, H, I, J, A. Keep going down. Have you seen Christians going to divorce? Have you seen Christians going into divorce? That is because they have not followed God's plan, and so their life will face different kinds of problems. Let me ask you, do you have problems in your life? Do you find it hard to overcome the problems? Do you find sometimes you are weak? And have maybe depression, unhappiness, instead of being joyful all the time, it's because we have not entered the perfect plan of God. Do you want to enter this perfect plan of God? It's very simple. Let me tell you a few things we can do. You all know this. First, repent of all sins, hate sins, knowing that sins are very destructive. First, believe that sins are destructive, so we hate sins. You know, one key to overcome sins, let me tell you the key. Whenever the sinful thought comes up, believe that it's destructive. And then you pray to God and say no to it. It's so simple. For instance, how come many Christian men sees a beautiful woman, and keep looking at a beautiful woman? Why? Because the Christian man thinks that it's fun to look at a woman. It's enjoyable to look at a woman. So they let the sin stay in their life. But when we realize that this will destroy our life and destroy God's plan and destroy our marriage, then we'll say, no, I don't want to look at a woman to make me sin. Let me tell you, if I see a woman who is sexy, charming, and makes me have thoughts, immediately I will turn away my head. Because I know that this will destroy God's plan in my life. And I will turn away. So it's very important that we say no to sins and know that they're very destructive. Or when you are about to be angry. For instance, this represents somebody. And he yells at you. And what do you want to do? When he yells at you, you want to yell at him too, right? You might want to stare at him and or say bad words to him or even hit him because we let the anger come out. But when we know that this is destructive and say, this is destructive, and then Lord, please help me and come to the Lord, and we can overcome all kinds of sins. The key to overcoming sins is to be aware of the presence of sins and know that it's destructive and immediately pray to God to change your life. Now let me tell you the four keys, the five keys. First, aware, say it together, aware.
Aware.
Aware of the sins or problems. Second, Destructive. Say it. Destructive. It is destructive. Third, biblical principles. Say it. Biblical principles. Or just say Bible. So use the Bible to say, what should I do? And number four, pray. Say it. Pray. And number five, choose to obey. Say it. Choose to obey. The key to overcome sins. Very simple. Say it together. One, aware.
Aware
that I have a desire to sin. I'm about to be angry. I'm about to have lust. Second, destructive. It is, say it, destructive. It is destructive. And then third, Bible. Use the Bible and say, this is destructive. And then number four, pray. Lord Jesus, help me. And then number five, choose not to look at that sexy woman. Choose not to be angry. Choose to love. Choose to have compassion on people and forgive them. So this is the key to overcoming sins. And when we overcome sins, you know, in the past I find it very hard to overcome sins. But now, when I know my life is very precious, and I want to make the best of my life, I find that when the sins come out, I can overcome it when I become aware of it right away and take care of it right away. Any kind of negative thoughts, for instance, when somebody did something bad to me, it's very natural for us to dislike this person, right? When we see this person, we might not like the person. But then I become aware, I don't like this person now because what the person has done. Immediately I know this is destructive. And I learn from the Bible to love people, to love our enemies. And then I pray, Lord Jesus, help me to respect and honor this person, to look at the good things of this person, and to bless the person. And then finally, I choose to bless. So in my mind, if I find that I dislike somebody, immediately I take care of that. So that's a very important key to revival. Say no to sins. Hate sins. Hate sins. Number two, what we can do is keep trusting in God. Yes, God is good. God has a wonderful plan in my life. God is going to do great things in my life. That's number two. Trust in God. Say it together. Trust in God. And number three, have a close relationship with God. Say it. Have a close relationship with God. And Jesus said, he who is in me, I'm in him also. And he will bear much fruit. When you're in him all the time, then we'll bear much fruit. And then, love the Lord. Say it together. Love the Lord. You know, I love the Lord all the time because I like the Lord. He's so good. When I think of God, I think of all the good things he has done. I always like him. So from morning till nighttime, I always say, Lord, you're so good. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And I find the presence of God in me all the time. And when I pray for people, I see that people experience the presence of God. And you too can carry this presence of God. And then the next point is to obey God. Say it together. To obey God. Because Jesus said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But only he who does the will of my Father in heaven. So when we obey him, then he's pleased with us. And then number six, to find the will of God and obey him and make the best use of our life. Say it together, to make the best use of our life. When you find that you can lead worship, then you really go into a powerful way of leading worship and really enjoy it. When you find that you can counsel someone, then you help people. When you find that you can do evangelism, then you do it. And you find that you will do it better and better and better. And this way, your life will be, God will put your life in a high place. You can do greater and greater things for God. Okay, let's go through this again. Say it together. First, say no to sin. Say no to sin. Second, trust in God. And number three, have a close relationship with God. And number four, love God. And number five, obey. Let's go through this again. First, say no to sin. Do you say no to sin?
Yes.
Or do you have sins that stay in your life? Now many people, they say no to some sins, but certain sins, they cannot say no. They find it hard to overcome anger or lust or some secret sins. But we know that all this is destructive and God knows our heart. So first, say no to sin. Number two, trust in God. Say it together. Trust in God. So believe that He has a wonderful plan. God is going to do great things for me. God is going to lift up my life. And number three, close relationship with God. Say it, please. Close relationship with God. And then number four, love God.
Love God.
That's the greatest commandment, to love God. And then number five, obey God. And then number six, make the best use of our life. Now when God has given me all these teachings and also infilled the Holy Spirit, I find that I can do great things for God, and you can do great things for God too. You know, the worship here is great. When you bring people here to worship together, their life will be transformed. So this is one area God has used you, and you can make the best use of this. And that is one strategy of God. And God has different strategies for each person. And for instance, for me, when I find that God can use me to help certain people, I look for ways how to use it better and better. Actually, remember that man I told you that dreamed about me and saw me being bald, preaching, remember that man? And a wife became a minister. And that man, one time, he prophesied to me. He actually, at that time, he was still a weak Christian. But God spoke to him, and he said, I saw you going over all the world to different places. At that time, to me, it was impossible. But now I've gone to different countries. So God really wants to use you. Each person has a different way to be used by God. You have a special way. Do you believe that?
Yes.
You can become a special person.
Amen.
It's very important each day you say to yourself and declare this, God has a wonderful plan in my life. Can you say it? God has a wonderful plan in my life. I can become a great person.
I can become a great person.
I can do great things for God.
I can do great things for God.
I can have great influence in the marketplace.
I have a great influence in the marketplace.
I can bring people in the kingdom of God.
I can
pray for people and they experience the Holy Spirit.
I can pray for people and experience the Holy Spirit.
I can pray for the sick and they can be healed. I can pray for deliverance of people. Do you believe this?
Yes.
You know, Jesus said, these signs will follow those who believe. And in my name, they will cast out demons. And they will lay hands on the sick and they will be healed. So Jesus has given us that authority. We have that authority, but many people don't use it. Let me ask you, do you believe in miracles?
Yes.
How many believe in miracles? Please raise your hand. Wonderful. Okay, put down your hands. How many of you are praying for people and you see and you saw miracles? When you pray for someone, not the pastor, when you pray for someone and you saw a miracle happen, please raise your hand. Not so many hands, right? At first, everybody. Now, not so many hands. Why? Because we didn't do it. Because we are afraid. Let me tell you, after I experienced the Holy Spirit, I said, this is so wonderful. I can experience His presence. And I started praying for people in my church and also in different places. At that time, I was teaching in a traditional seminary. But I was very courageous. I prayed for my seminary students. And then the leaders don't like it. Because in the traditional church, they don't believe in the laying of hands and they don't believe in Holy Spirit coming to transform people. And so they warned me. But I kept praying for people. And one time I led a meeting. And actually it was just a short time after I experienced the Holy Spirit. And then I asked the pastor, because the pastor asked me to preach there, can I pray for some people, lay hand on them? He said, okay, you go to another room. Whoever wants to go, go there. So there were about 20 people who went to another room. And I prayed for each one of them. And then I asked her, did you experience anything? And one woman jumped up. She said, my backache is healed. And another woman jumped up, my shoulder ache is healed.
Yes.
It was the first time that I prayed for someone and I saw healing right away.
Amen.
And after that, I saw many, many miracles. One time I saw a cancer patient, the cancer went away. The cancer was diagnosed by the doctor. And then after the prayer, during the prayer, she felt she had breast cancer, and she felt something dark left her body. And then she was filled with joy, and then she found the pain went away. She had pain for over a month. And then she went back to check, and then the checkup, and the doctor said she has no cancer. And I've seen different kinds of miracles. And God can use it. God can use you. That you can be shining for Jesus in the marketplace. Wherever you go, when you do what I just said to you, say no to sin and have a good trust in Jesus and have a good relationship with Him, and then you love Him and you obey Him, and then you make the best use of your life, you find that your life will blossom. But many Christians come to church, they really like to worship and like to dance. Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! I like to dance, hallelujah! But when they go home, they fight. When they go home, they get angry. So, it's just in the church. It's just a church experience. Does God want that?
No.
God wants us to invite Him into every area of our life. In a prayer, in the Lord's Prayer, your kingdom come. Now, He has three different meanings. First, the kingdom of grace come. All people believe in Jesus. Second, the end of the world will come. The kingdom of glory will come when Jesus comes back. But there is another meaning. Your heart, your family, your daily life become the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is where God rules. Say it together. The kingdom of God is where God rules. So when your heart is totally dedicated to God and say, Lord, you rule my life. Lord, you rule my tongue. Lord, you rule my family. You rule my marriage life. You rule my church life. You rule my working life. So if God rules in your life, He will bless you. And you can be used by God, and you will enter into a greater and greater plan of God. Let me tell you, few people go into plan A. Plan A is very perfect. But it's okay, even if you are in plan G now, you can go up to F, E, D. You can keep going up. When you keep following God, Lord, I want to live out the perfect plan of God.
Yes.
Have you been to a cemetery and then see gravestones? This person was born certain day, died certain day, and this person has passed away. Now one day we might have a gravestone ourselves, and then people say he was born and then he passed away on that day. Is that how your life will be only? Or will your life be saying you will bless many people and one day you go to heaven? God said all this group of people have been blessed by you. Do you want that? All this group of people, you have blessed them, you have brought them to Jesus, you have revived their spiritual life. And I hope when you hear this message, your heart will be stirred. Yes, Lord, I want to enter this perfect plan of God. Can you say it? Yes, Lord, I want to enter this perfect plan of God. I want to be revived. You know, some people pray for revival. Lord Jesus, revival come. Revival come to Africa. Revival come to Kenya. But let me tell you, revival can come to you tonight. When you're willing to do those things I just told you, when you're willing to follow God, revival can come to your heart today. You don't have to wait. Sometimes we wait for a long time for a revival to come to Kenya, to different places. But revival can come to you today.
Amen.
And you can start to make a big, big difference.
Amen.
Do you want that to happen?
Yes.
Now tonight I'm going to spend a little time on how to pray for people and how to pray. And that way, tomorrow we'll talk about how to use that for evangelism and for other purpose. You know, the key to how to pray with the power of God. Now with the power of God, sometimes people will fall down. I've seen many people fall down when I pray for them. But it doesn't have to be falling down. Some people may experience peace, love, joy, comfort, or demons being driven out. When you have a heart to hunger for God, His presence will come to you. When you really cry out to God from your heart, you can practice doing this. Crying out from your heart, "Oh Lord Jesus, hallelujah!" Oh, from your heart, from the bottom of your heart, that is worshiping God in spirit and in truth. Oh, and you will notice that if you do that every day, you find that you have the power of God. Let me tell you, every time now, I don't have to cry like this. When I think of Jesus, because I'm going to do it from the bottom of my heart, when I think of Jesus, immediately His power will come upon me. Immediately His joy will come to me. You can do it, practice it, keep doing it, so that your heart is totally open to God. Now at this point, I'm going to ask two volunteers who hunger for God. If you hunger for God, two persons come up. I demonstrate praying for you. To demonstrate how to pray from the Spirit. If you hunger for God, would you come out? Two persons. Okay, one more. God bless you. Here's a wonderful person. He introduced himself to me and told me about his ministry. Hallelujah. Worship is great. Okay, could someone hold the mic for me? And then we need a catcher behind them. Two catchers behind them. Will you come forward? Come forward. Now, I'm going to demonstrate, and I would like you to do that tonight. We'll do it, practice it later. But first, just, and then first we invite the person. So keep your eyes closed and hunger for God. And believe that God is loving you right now. God is in front of you and behind you. God is laying His hand on you. And then I tell them to do that. And then for myself, I reach out my heart to God. It's like my spirit ascend to God. Oh, hallelujah. Now you can all stand up and pray together. Oh, hallelujah.
Chiesa, pregherò, chiesere, prego, anzi chiesere, ma sì, chiedere,
chiedere, chiedere, chiedere,
chiedere, chiedere, chiedere, prego, sì,
chiedere, chiedere, what you experienced?
Okay.
Can you talk louder?
She experienced joy.
Nothing to laugh about, then the joy just comes out, right? Do you feel light in the body? It's like floating, right? Now this is, it came from the presence of God. And let me tell you, you can be trained. You can be trained to have this presence of God. And tonight I'm going to pray for you and also demonstrate how to do it. And we're going to ask her to share later, or not. Apparently, she's been filled with the Holy Spirit. So basically, now, thank you, Peter. God bless you. He's a great man. Now, reach out your heart to God. Oh! Now, try everyone. Everyone try it. Oh! Now, this man, the new man, sir, you want to come up and pray for you again? Come. And the rest of you, now you keep doing this, and then for those who want me to pray for you, you can come to the front. I know, you know, there are many people who carry great anointing in the world. Sometimes we look at these people and say, it's impossible to be like that. Relax. But what I want to tell you is, tonight I'm going to share with you how you can have the anointing of God. That by loving God, putting down your sin, and let your spirit flow to God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now when you feel the power of God come upon you, relax. Oh, relax now. The power of God. You know, some people, when they feel the power come upon them, they are afraid to fall down. But let me tell you, I've seen people fall down. Immediately, they went to heaven. They didn't die, but the spirit poured out of them. They saw Jesus and came back. And some people experienced, like her, she experienced, they didn't feel the Holy Spirit. And some people experienced joy or love. Relax. I hope you all hunger for the Holy Spirit. And the point is, now I'm training you how you can have the anointing of God. Do you want to carry the power and anointing of the Holy Spirit? Because when you have the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you can do great things for God. And you can pray for the sick and they be healed. And you can pray for people and they experience the presence of God. And also when you intercede, you find it much easier to intercede when you are filled with the Holy Spirit. So what everyone trying to do is, oh, hallelujah, try that. Hallelujah. 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 Try it. Now, can you share what you experience, how you feel, physically and also in your heart? Can you describe it?
Nikitoa maneno haya mimi nataka tufuzili pia naongea lakini kuongea kwangu nasikia pia naongea huyu. Naona kile yako hapo. Mimi nasikia kwa roho yako nasikia pia naongea. Utafikiri natafuzili sinasikia pia naongea lakini kipio usiroa kitu nasikia kwa roho yangu pia naongea. Siku kifanya tukwambiwa nasikia huyu anaongea. Aziz.